Here I'll be talking about the utility projects of renewable energy in India. Before that, Adani Green Energy Limited, it's basically one of the group companies of Adani and developing in wind projects as well as solar. This financial year we have a target of like put up of 2000 megawatt, and we have achieved till date around 1218 megawatt till date, and others are in a different phase of commissioning and mostly located in Karnataka, South India. North India we have already completed most of the projects. We have also footprint in the wind also, where we have already commissioned 66 megawatt and 150 megawatt is in pipeline, which we are going to complete in next 6 months. We have signed a MOU with the Rajasthan and about 10,000 megawatt to develop a solar park. We have already currently doing Bhadla solar park of 500 megawatt, and we have already initiated 1500 megawatt Fatehgarh solar park. So we have already got the connectivity of 400 kV lines, 750 each from the RVPN as well as PGCIL. And we have a great in-house engineering capability. We have a well-managed project management team. We are delivering the all projects. This is all the Adani Green. Let us, I will now, the utility projects in India, the scenario. So basically all the, these are the grid interactive renewable power projects under National Solar Mission, mainly through the private investment driven with tariff policy regimes. As you know, we have been hearing that we have installed capacity of around 60 gigawatt out of total thermal wind entire generation of 330 gigawatt. And we have been also hearing that we have a target of 175 gigawatt renewable power by year 2022, where 100 gigawatt is only solar. We have to complete by 2022. These are the all awarded through the SECI, CPSU, state through bidding and under the various stage of implementation. I will basically speak about the challenges we face in utility projects, like grid connectivity varies across, apart from the park, where the we need to take non-park, where we have to take the land as well as grid connectivity. Those are the major challenges. Apart from the park, and different, all the states have the different policies. If I talk about the mainly like Telangana and Andhra, where you have a connectivity, you'll get it, but the all this, like even if your plant end, the entire design has to be approved from the utilities. So that was the major bottleneck is there, where as compared to the north, where you have a full design of your own in the in plant. So these are the major challenges. And if you this switch yard, if you are talking about the switch yard in the south, like Telangana, and there every this small switch yard is there, because you have a 30 megawatt, 50 megawatt plants are there. So for that you don't need a big switch yard, you have only transformer and the line. So there they, we have to, because the Telangana policy is such that you have to put a SAS system, substation automation system, where it is, that is not justified there. But these are the challenges which we are facing. Like these two small switch yard, where we can do it with the conventional sort of things. Then the tariff metric, it is a very, it's a totally uniform in the entire state. As per the SECI and then CA guidelines, where we have a main and check and standby metering. It has to be at the remote location, interface point, where all these two will be separate there itself. But the state has a different policies, where they have certain, the plant end one will be there and other end another will be there. But as per the SECI and NTPC, the all the and CA guidelines, if that metering location has to be a remote location. But there are also some issues are there with, because putting this the metering in the remote locations, the bay, the standby metering and the main and check, the bay length will get increases. So because of that, there is a restrictions on that. So some states are allowing, some states are not allowing. But see, we all the SECI projects, we have to follow the SECI guidelines. So they are enforcing us to put that remote end also. Whatever the line length, whatever the bay length will increase. So that is a challenge that we are taking up with the state utilities and getting it done, but it has a challenge. Then the reactive power requirement. This is something which we have a grid where most of the plants, thermal power plants and others are like rotating machines where the grid frequencies are monitored. So, but in solar, there is no such frequencies and all. So it's a basically static type of devices. And when these are keep on adding in the grid, so there is a misbalancing of the reactive power. So a state like Karnataka, they have clearly stated that every 20 megawatt, you have to provide plus minus 4 MVAR reactive power. So this is the guideline they have strictly they have issued. But what industry practice is that we are using the inverter capability, power capability, where you have a cushion of that reactive power, which is being utilized all the or entire across the industry, but the witness is being not done. Somewhere it is done, but somewhere not it is not done. So if you see, if it is really we have to take the reactive power management from the inverter, then you losing your reactive power as well, because the inverter is rated for unity power factor, the capacity is rated for unity power factor. But if this reactive power implementation is there, then depending on the grid, you have to this 0.95 and 95 lagging factor you have to maintain. If you go like that, then you are going to lose the active power. But in overseas, there is different phenomena. There we have a called PSS, where this is a power system stabilizer, which controls, we have a static VAR compensator. Depending on the grid, it will take capacitor as well as inductor, so that they maintain the power factor. Other is like telemetry requirement. That is also it's a totally non-informed entire across the state. Like in Karnataka, they don't want your real time of generation data of the plant, and they need only remote end data. And other like in Telangana and Andhra, they need your plant data, and that also not through the like GPRS and other GPRS based, because not the most of the data is on GPRS based, but they have strictly on the if it is a 132 kV line, then you have to provide through the PDH based forte panel or PLCC or lease line. Lease line also they have a clear cut guidelines that you have to provide 132 kV and below 132 kV, 33 kV you have to provide lease line. But in northern state and all, they have a flexibility. It's a lease, you can provide data or lease line or either from GPRS also. So this is the non-uniformity across the India we are facing here. Now the features of LVRT, this is now being made mandatory in inverter as well as now wind converter as well. So this is also a challenges in the wind industry, where you have to wind converter has to made a LVRT compliant. There is also a provision of control features from the SLDC, where they can control the entire power through the set point. It's basically grid security warrants, they will control it from there itself. If something you have to 100 megawatt plant, they have to reduce 10%, they can reduce 10 megawatt, but not in for single inverter or single wind machine. They can, it will proportionally affect all machines. So this is the where it will come implemented as per the ICC code. Now this I'll talk about how the technology selections is going to affect our plants. we have a fixed AC capacity in our plant. If I'll talk about the 50 megawatt plant, it's nothing but 50 megawatt AC. But the DC capacity is keep on varying. Earlier, if I'll talk about the tracker, where I can achieve 20% loading with the same 30% loading in the fixed or seasonal tilt, the same generation I can achieve. So now the industry, we are seeing the loading is keep on increasing. Now we are loading up to the 47 or 40, 50%. Because the falling module prices and the cost of tracker and all, if you'll compare, so then there, of course, there will be loading in the DC side, there is a clipping losses. But that also take together, there is advantage on that. Loading of the DC in inverters. So, other is like central versus string. There also we have, because the land profile and all, if you talk about the advantage of the string, definitely it has a multi MPPT where there will be a lot of undulations in the plant. If I have a central inverter, if I talk about the 5 megawatt block, the ACB is connected around that, have a different length, so there is a voltage drop. So the single MPPT has a certain disadvantage over the generation of the solar generation. And string, because of the multi MPPT features, each string small size have multiple MPPT. Even if the more undulations will be there, it will generate more and more power. Of course, there is a certain lacuna is there, but it will fit in the this Indian environment. Because the this across the India, your land is not flat. So definitely the string utilization comes, it has more impact on the generation. So the technology selection again, if 1500 volt DC system, it has impact, it has a certain benefits like low losses, and it has BOS cost is also less, but it this 15 volts all equipment has to be first commoditized. It will definitely come into near future, and and we industry will prefer solar park where the land is at one place, the common infrastructures are there, and you need not to bother about the connectivity and land. So definitely a solar park will be welcome, and we have to move on that direction also. Storage, as my colleague told me, of the storage that will play a major role in like in a solar power plant where the PV smoothing. There is two issues are there with the storage. That one is like PV smoothing where the clouds will come, certain there is a drop of the generation, so the battery will immediately for the 2 minutes and all it will take care of that part. And the other is a load balancing where you have a demand and that supply gap is there where it can be more useful. This I think I have completed. Thank you. Thank you very much.